Hello, and I must I must first simply apologize for not sending the material sufficiently far in advance, and most especially to the discussants who have no doubt not had sufficient time to look at it. So, right, well, I used to work for the European Commission for 26 years, quite a long time. I worked in the area of industrial analysis for the information technology and related industries. I did some analysis for the Uruguay round, the trade deal, and for the last, for two-thirds of the time I've been there, I've been in the research area, developing research programs and also implementing them. So I've been doing some work on this on these trade agreements, and in particular, what I try to do is I try to identify areas that nobody else is working on, or maybe some angle that nobody is working on, or at least that there's not enough work being done from that angle. So, based on a paper which a young Dutch legal scholar did, I became interested in regulatory cooperation in the TTIP, and then spread out from there to look at trade agreements more broadly. And I've written some. I think you've had access to the papers that have been written. One on TTIP and one on CETA. So, just to start, the traditional trade agreements were about tariffs and quotas. That is the GATT from 1947. And the tariffs are now very low. They're 3% across the Atlantic. And according to the World Bank, they're 2.7% average in the world. But that's a weighted figure. It surprised me that it was so low, but nevertheless, that is what they have. Because, and anyway, we can come back to the question. So, the current trade agreements include, most of them have little or nothing to do with trade. But nevertheless, they're favored by the rich countries and the companies who are based in those countries. These new agreements have things like regulatory cooperation, which is the newest institutional innovation that they've made. But it also addressed some issues like investment, competition, public procurement, and some aspects of services which have never been addressed before, or at least, yes, not implemented in agreements, at least, and intellectual property, these kinds of issues. So they're quite different from the other agreements, despite the public discourse that they're somehow the same, at least those advocating them. Another feature is that they're living agreements, which is a real innovation, and they can be changed afterwards. After they've been passed by parliaments, etc., they can be changed. And that process is extremely important, arguably. They're international treaties, and which means they override domestic laws. And that raises issues of democracy, which we will talk about. And there is this work on what has been called, I don't know how many of you have come across it, but the new constitutionalism by Stephen Gill is the main author, which is the idea that rules and regulations are being put into constitutions or constitution-like legal systems, which makes them virtually impossible to change, so also the I will talk about how policy and related to that regulations, well, in the form of regulations, is made. That is the process of it. Who influences it and how? And policy and regulations are really a two-way process. It's not that you have the policy somewhere up there and the regulations stem from it, as many might think, but they actually interact, because developments take place in the arena of regulations, which actually change the policy without necessarily any explicit choice or decision being made. So what happens at that level is extremely important. And the economic impact assessments for these agreements, for all these agreements, give an absolutely tiny gain. In the most optimistic scenarios, the most unrealistic scenarios, they still give a tiny gain. And then we'll come to that again. You may have seen it if you had a chance to read the papers. That raises a question. How is it that such a tiny economic gain can result in these, and which is the argument for, can result in these huge undertakings and these deep commitments for the future? How is that? That's I think, a pretty profound question. I will talk about how ideas are used, how things are framed, and their importance in policy and regulation, as well as in public debate. And also, there's a fundamental point that it is crucially important that public debate take place to get regulations that are in the public interest. And if they're not, if it's not in the public debate, there are serious problems, arguably. So if we start with what regulations are. So in everyday language, people often talk about regulations are red tape, they're useless, they're these Brussels bureaucrats trying to make life difficult for people. And in policy, they're often considered entirely as cost for business, or mainly as cost for business. For example, in the EU's regulatory fitness program, i.e. REFIT, it's called, and the German Norman Control Act, when they look at regulation, it's simply in terms of costs for business. And that's interesting. Like the European Commission Better Regulation site, they have a site where the public can give their input, and it's entitled Lighten the Load, Have Your Say. So this is it, actually. So what is it inviting when it's... there's some boxes down below which you can't see off screen, where you can enter text and you can annex documents, etc. So this is orienting in one direction. Now, regulations... Of course, when we stand back and look at them, they're about health and safety at work, consumer product safety, transport safety, food safety, public health regulations, clean water, clean air, protection of all sorts from toxic chemicals. They address the huge issues of climate change, regulation of the financial system, et cetera, employment protection. Now, the costs and benefits of regulations from the general discourse in public, you would say, well, the costs of regulations are must be huge if they're talking about it like this. And well, what are the benefits? So there has been economic assessments of these. In fact, there is on a continual basis in the United States. It's just part of the system. And for this, see where are we? Yeah, this is a chart of what the central agency in the United States, it's in the president's, centered in the presidential executive, which gathers the regulations from the, in fact, they all have to pass through this agency called OIRA. it's not actually officially an agency. It's an executive office close to the president. And this is what they have for all. It includes all regulations that have an economic effect, either on the cost or the benefit side, over 100 million in any given year. So this is what you see. You see the costs are what is in green, and the black is the benefits. Now, the way these things are analyzed in impact studies and in these studies, these regulatory review programs, is they focus on the green parts. And very often they focus entirely on the green parts, and the black parts are just completely ignored. Now, there are problems about cost-benefit analysis, which this is done, but the main problems about, because it's much easier to estimate the cost, but the benefits are hard to assess, and they often don't count benefits which they cannot quantify. So this, whatever one thinks about cost, neoclassical cost-benefit analysis, and I have to, anyway, it doesn't matter, we come back to that. You have a 6-to-1 ratio if you add all these up together of the benefits of the cost. So, now, in international trade agreements, there has been an increasing effort, successful effort, at disciplining regulations. So initially in the GATT, which started in 1947, there was a collective purpose, and that was stability in international trade, which, as Andrew Lang, who is an outstanding historian of this, puts it, it was this stability in international trade as a precondition for the achievement of domestic economic stability and full employment, and to ensure peace and prosperity for the world. So this is in the post-Second World War period. And trade disputes were solved diplomatically. Now, so it was about bringing down tariffs and quotas, and domestic regulations were seen as just as background institutional features of the different countries, that this country functions like this, this country functions like this, and that has nothing to do with trade. But in the 1970s, the US started to have a trade deficit. And there was slower growth in the 70s, and companies wanted to export with the slow domestic demand. And the big development was with the 1974 Trade Act in the US. So there was an institutionalization of a system of complaint against the differences between other countries' regulations and that of those of the United States. They were called trade barriers, non-tariff trade barriers, and they were called unfair, which rings some recent bells as well, but that's another story. Now, non-tariff barriers began to be addressed in trade agreements then through pushing from the United States in the GATT Tokyo in the 1970s, then in the 1980s into the 90s, and then with the formation of the that result culminated in the formation of the WTO, and there are two agreements within the WTO on technical barriers and on food safety and animal and plant health. That brings us up to the WTO, and at the same time there was a change in international trade law and its application. So differences in regulation things were conceived in market terms, not in other terms, which they could also be seen in, and so the differences in regulation became market distortions. Then from the time of the WTO being founded, with this new push on against regulatory differences, the vaguely worded, in these treaties, there are vague statements about these things, and it's up then to the dispute settlement system. It is a dispute settlement body which judges on these disputes, and it is that gives precise meaning to these through case law, and that's a very important process. And you find all sorts of fat books discussing these things, which are actually quite interesting. Well, it depends on your start, what else you have to do in life, but nevertheless. And the precautionary principle, which is mentioned in a couple of the papers, that of the three papers behind this that hopefully you have, the WTO dispute settlement system decided that the precautionary principle, even though it's written in a sort of qualified way into one of those agreements, into the the SPS agreement. It decided that the precautionary principle does not override other parts of the agreement, which then means that they override it in practice. So there were also efforts to make other bodies of international law, those related to human rights and the environment, to put them on top of trade and be superior to them from the 1990s. And again, the WTO dispute settlement system decided they're not going to deal with them. They decided to consider only trade, which meant that the others were entirely not taken into account in these. And the crucial point about trade is that trade has penalties and enforcement. Penalties can be big. And that's what makes the trade system so powerful in the whole international legal system, and what some people have called trade über alles in the German sense. So, now, new trade agreements have been developing. New types of trade agreements have been developing from the late 1990s. There has been in the sort of standard multilateral system where all the different countries are involved, they started the Doha Development Round in 2001. But in the last meeting in Nairobi in December 2015, before that and since then, the rich countries said, that's over. Now it's time to concentrate on the new issues. The Doha Development Round had issues that the developing countries were interested in, like agriculture and food security, those kinds of things. But the rich countries said, "Okay, that's the end of that. You're not going to agree to the things that we want. We push them aside." So then these coalitions of the willing started to come together, and that is the country and of course the big companies behind them who are involved in the trades, international trade, they went to put these various things like competition, public procurement, etc., intellectual property, etc., these things that the developing countries refused to have in the multilateral trade round, instead they went off and they did it themselves. And this raises the question of the kicking away the ladder for the developing countries, i.e. kick this idea. I don't know whether you have been working on that kind of thing. But Friedrich List in the 19th century and Ha-Jun Chang, of course, picked it up in his book in 2004 on this question, so that the rich countries develop in a certain way. And then once they're developed, they prevent the others from developing in the same way, like putting up tariff barriers for infant industries, setting up state companies, and a whole range of things. And in fact, stealing intellectual property from other countries, etc. All these things were just banned then for the people who came, the countries who came after. So, the EU's Trade for All policy takes this approach as well. And that was published in, what was it, 2015, 14, as the latest policy statement. Now, there's pressure on regulation so comes from two sides. It comes from this trade side, or supposed trade, but also from the domestic side. So regulatory cooperation is something I focused on particularly, because it's completely new, and it's arguably very important when you start sort of poking into it. Now, regulatory cooperation is a process where the two sides get together and cooperate on regulations. And it intervenes right in the process of developing of regulations. And there's in the preamble to these new agreements, that is these free trade agreements like the TTIP, the TPP, the TISA, the Trade and Services Agreement, the CETA, etc. they state at the beginning that countries have the right to regulate. The problem is that they then go on later somewhere else to constrain that right. So that, for example, in regulatory cooperation, they say, well, or indeed in other parts of it, they say, well, in fact, I'll specifically mention regulatory cooperation now, that regulations be no more trade restrictive than necessary. Now, I discuss this brings up the necessity test, which has been examined in these judgments. And I discussed that in one of the papers, in the CETA paper, in fact, as to how this functions in practice. It might look fairly innocuous, but in fact, it has a strong deregulatory thrust. And I quote some very well known academics about that. Now, the objectives in regulatory cooperation are very important because you could say, well, it's a good idea to get here. We can learn from each other. This is what the discourse is. So we can have a gold standard. Everyone can raise their regulations, learn from each other, and have better regulations. But in practice, the objectives are to increase trade. That's the primary objective. This becomes a defining constraint in the actual practice of regulatory cooperation. Also, as part of these treaties, they have the mutual recognition of that regulations are equivalent. Now, they don't actually say how they're going to do it in the treaties, and this is absolutely crucial. It also refers to regulations in the past, not just future regulations. And regulations in the past can be very different. In the TTIP paper, you'd see the differences in regulations between the United States and Europe, for example, in a number of areas it is mentioned. And they're really profound, and they're systemic differences. They're not just simply that one choose one and could change it the next day. They're part of the institutional system and the way the system works in both places. Yet, mutual recognition can say, well, and in fact, this is the way it's been discussed in some of the literature, the policy and academic literature, that if the objectives are the same of the regulations, let's keep food safe or whatever, then they should be accepted so that food developed in one area should be accepted in the other, even though the systems may be quite different. Like, for example, in the European system, you have, in the European food processing system, you have checks at each stage, and there's traceability. In case there's any contamination, they can know exactly where it's from. In the United States, in things like, this famous chicken carcasses being washed with lactic acid, etc. But it's the same for beef and things. So at the end of the process, they apply some chemicals to get rid of any contamination. But this is not accepted in Europe as being so, and so there's a barrier. But anyway, that's just one example. But there's a legion of examples across all sorts of different areas. The institutional system they set up for regulatory cooperation, they would have a committee at the top and a number of working groups below. So the working groups would be essentially work on sectors, or they could work on some horizontal issues, but they would largely work on sectors. And in practice, these are likely to be completely dominated, because we know from the way domestic regulation works, that they're completely dominated by big business, because they have the resource, big business and their associations, because they have the resources to do this. The NGOs can't do it. And I mentioned in the TTIP paper how Jennifer Sass of the National Resources Development Council in the United States said that she's a scientist working for a big NGO. She turns up at meetings and she's the only one from civil society, and the rest is wall-to-wall business when they're talking about regulation domestically in the United States. Also they address both new regulations, these new agreements, and reviews of existing regulations. And in the process, and there's some things in the process that they point to, like the early access to preparation of regulations, transparency for the regulators only, and consultation with stakeholders, which in practice turns out, if you look at the actual consultations that are done around trade agreements, like in the preparation of the TTIP, something like 93% of the consultations were done with business, and the rest with all the civil society groups and trade unions, to environmental NGOs, public health NGOs, etc., etc., etc. There was just a handful of meetings with those as to how the TTIP should be prepared, and the working groups which I mentioned, which again in practice will be completely dominated by business. Now, in the CETA, they don't mention work. It's completely untransparent. I mean, while transparency has been a big issue in the United States, and in fact the United States insists, and we have from leaked, you can see from the leaks that appeared from Greenpeace, on the American statements on regulatory, the positions that they took on regulatory cooperation, they insist that everything be written down in great detail. And the reason for this, the reason for this, I think I can say it's straightforward without putting, if you like, uncertainty on it, is for judicial review. In the United States, judicial review is a fundamental part of the regulatory system. The Environmental Protection Agency tried to ban asbestos in 1990, and a court case was taken against them by the producers of asbestos, and they came in with thousands of pages of documents to support their thing. But the court went through it, the court experts went through it, and they found some little thing that they said was not correct. And so the whole thing was thrown out. And still today, the United States does not ban asbestos. Now, they ban them in particular, very specific things, but they still don't have a general ban in asbestos like Europe does, even though Europe did it quite late, but that's another story. But after a process, all this process, where you have business on both sides of the Atlantic, and remember, business is not just coming from one side. The businesses are implanted on both sides. These businesses are that are involved here. So they're already implanted in both sides. But anyway, so that if something is put forward by business on both sides in agreement, that is likely to be accepted by this committee at the top, and then sent on. So, but it's only at that point that it goes to the Council, the Member States, and the European Parliament. So to come back to the transparency thing, which is a really big issue, In the CETA, there is no transparency. There's no provision for transparency of what's going on. There are some optional consultation with stakeholders, but there's no legal constraint on this happening. And in these treaties, you need legal constraints for things to happen. Otherwise, things take on a momentum because of the culture that builds up. So at that point, if it gets that far, because a lot of things may be blocked at that point, and these are not just new regulations, there are also changes, because often regulations need to be changed because of changing circumstances or new scientific developments or whatever. So anyway, at that point, if it gets that far, it goes to the member states on the European side and the European Parliament. But only then. All the rest has been, at that point, the show is almost over. Obviously, they can object, but it's going to be very difficult to object if you have all this pressure from and there's all this massive lobbying that takes place at the European level and the US, Canadian, etc. level. Well, we can discuss that further if you want. But so there's another feature which is used to tie down regulations, which is called good regulatory practice. And that's written into some of these trade agreements as well. More in some than in others. It's more in the what the Europeans have put forward for TTIP. And it's just mentioned as a term in CETA, but you often get a lot of the details of what's meant by this. And what is this good regulatory practice? Well, the EU put forward, it said, as laid down in the OECD, this classic OECD statement of 2012, because there's been a lot of work going on in the OECD since the mid-1990s, which has been another thrust to constrain regulations. And the OECD has come up with various statements of good regulatory practices which evolved from from the 1990s. They came up, it was based originally on the US model, and I have a reference in one of the papers there from somebody who's intimately engaged in all this who points it out. And the features that are in it are things like ensure that the benefits justify the cost, maximize the net benefit, which implies cost-benefit analysis. Even though it appears to leave it more open, that's the thrust of what they're talking about. And this is neoclassical cost-benefit analysis, which is going to become even more important in the United States with the new administration, and they have said this, to block regulations. And in fact, to do away with regulations, do away with a lot of the... with what they want to do is do away with many of the existing regulations. We'll come back to that. There has to be there has to be these various things: transparency and openness, and so that business can contribute. Well, anybody, but in fact, only one actor has the resources to do it. Contribute to draft proposal. That is to do it on a sustained basis, so that they will actually succeed. And to the supporting, they could contribute to the supporting analysis as well. And business is very well organized for this. They have these think tanks, which they fund, which some of these are very big, and very influential, and affect the public debate. They write for newspapers, etc. Anyway. So there are a number of features then. A review of existing regulations, which focuses on costs. These kind of things that you find if you look through what the OECD model is. And they mention these things like judicial review, etc. But then CETA, for example, you have a list of these kind of things, even though... Now, the perspective in this good regulatory practice is a technocratic process that is not political. Despite all those issues that are being addressed, it's not political. And the emphasis is on costs for business. And this is a system which they try to implement and enforce around the world. And just to mention the role of the OECD, which has great symbolic power, and there's some interesting analysis of this in the trade area. Like Matthew Eagleton has a book about symbolic power in the WTO, which is a very interesting study of. Well, maybe we'll get in discussion because I need to press on. Maybe no, actually I'll mention it. It was about the so-called Cotton Four. Basically, there are four countries in Africa, in sort of central North Africa, whose cotton is superior to anywhere else around the world for various natural and traditional reasons. Much superior, in fact, and it's very much wanted by people who make clothes, etc. But it's being pushed out of the market by the massive subsidies that there are, for notably in the United States, because the cotton producers in the United States are extremely powerful in a number of these southern states, and they're extremely well organized as well. So they try to have a push, taking the WTO at its word and its rules. Okay, let's follow the rules. The others should stop subsidizing, etc., because they're undercutting ours, and ours is better quality, etc. But somehow, through collaboration between the WTO employees, according to this book, and push from the United States in particular, which itself has great symbolic power in the sense that it has people follow its ideas very much, they somehow diverted this into something whereby some technical assistance would be given to these countries in their development if they withdrew this proposal. Anyway, that's a book which is interesting on this question of symbolic. It's also mentioned by Andrew Lang in his outstanding book on the history of all this stuff. The OECD has been described in a foreign affairs article as the enforcer of Western norms. And it brings together people who are involved in the making of policy and those who influence them, these experts from academia, etc. Anyway, so I mentioned one thing about the framework, about the job study of 1994. The OECD job study was, I don't know to what extent you've come across it in your course or in your other work, but it was of simply enormous importance because it argued and convinced everybody that there was a scientific basis for labor market rigidities would cause higher unemployment. And they proved it by showing various regressions, various studies like that. So, but it was, there's a critical literature which is mentioned actually in one of the papers, I think in the last paper, the one with the title of this that I only sent in the day before yesterday or whenever, I just lost my train of thought. Which shows how this was actually, that the correlations no longer happened, were no longer true if you moved on a bit, and certain countries were left out, and of course that's a favorite of economists, as you probably know, of how do you get out of the data, how do you get the right answer for the problem that you want to, the policy you want to promote, you just leave out the data. Now you've no doubt heard of the Reinhardt and Rogoff thing. Now there was supposed to be accidentally left out, but in any case, it gave the right answer. And this is a common thing, and I know that people do it in their PhDs, etc., and things like that. But it's the way of doctoring the results to give the right answer. Anyway, there's a literature there which discusses that, but that has had a huge effect on labor market effect, and in fact, so that, for example, the French. The employment laws brought in France were a result ultimately of this kind of work, because it got taken up by all the parties in Western, including the social democratic parties. In fact, all the social democratic parties in Europe accepted this, and it made a huge difference. And indeed, some of them promoted it, like in the UK and in Germany. Anyway, I'll pass on. So good regulatory practice. Now, this good regulatory practice, they give as examples, the OECD give the US system and the UK system as sort of top rating. So the US system is rated very highly. So, but Robert Weissman, who is head of a very big consumer advocacy group, Public Citizen, this is what he had to say about it. Unreasonable delay permeates almost all aspects of the rulemaking process. That means the regulatory process, in fact. And the source of the problem is a thicket of legislatively mandated, that is by Congress, mandated processes and multiple analyses that have to be done, along with, he says, inappropriate influence exerted by the regulated parties and on their behalf. That is the companies, because they have to bear the costs of these regulations, and they're extremely hostile to them, especially in the United States. But that's what you end up with in this system, according to him, and I think he's a good judge, at least in my opinion. In the UK system, which is rated as top of the world by the OECD, the New Economics Foundation, who I think are quite good and in fact very good in general and balanced. They say that a large and unaccountable bureaucracy has been created with the express purpose of making it more difficult for government departments to pass laws and impose costs on business, and corporations are being invited to write their own rules. So this is the result of this, and these are the ones that are held up as the best example. So I think one could argue that what's called good regulatory practice, you could really say is bad regulatory practice, if what these people say too. I would also like to now like to take the example of services, because this is an area that's not well, not widely discussed, and I'll just have one slide on it here to say, well, what is services trade in the first instance? In traditionally, services was ignored because it said, well, services had to be provided in the country, locally in any country, and so there's no trade involved. But gradually, from the late 1970s, the financial companies in the United States began to get mobilized on this. So Federal Express, Citibank, AIG, started mobilizing people, and in the 1990s, the same thing happened in Europe. But so in the thinking in the trade system at the WTO, they have four modes of trade. So you can sell from abroad, like through the internet. You can travel to a country where the service is provided to you. So like tourism, commercial presence, which is a really important one, and I will come to that in a moment. And the transfer of labor. Now, one of these four things is called mode three. It's commercial presence, which in fact is investment. And there are no limits. You cannot prevent this. In other words, you can't limit the number of people producing in an area. You can't limit the size of them. Essentially, you have to take off more or less your size. And number in particular, are you just have to leave anybody come in and provide a thing, whether it be hotels in an area for tourism, whether it be supermarkets, etc., etc. Now, this is a rather curious thing. It's an example of putting everything under trade and therefore being subjugated to it, to these trade disciplines, in other words, constraints. Now, if we look at the actual statistics that are provided, here we have, this is what trade exports from the EU are said by Eurostat. And you can see that the yellow, or sorry, excuse me, the blue slice, the dark blue slice, which is close to 70%, is enormous and completely outweighs the others. But is that investment, is that really trade? It's not included in the trade statistics, for one thing. The trade statistics use balance of payments data. Remember that this is setting up a business. It's what would be called if foreign direct investment, if it was manufacturing. And the way they measure it statistically, like this, is simply looking at the sales of the foreign subsidiaries, but it's only the other three parts that you find in the actual trade statistics. So there's a complete disjunction between what's in the trade as viewed by the trade, which are actual balance, which are actually payments made, and what is included here. So this enormous area is put under this heading, and so the constraints come on in the interests, obviously, of the companies who want to invest. Another example of putting things under trade is what they call localization, and this applies to both goods and services. So no local government or other government preference is allowed for local suppliers. Above a certain threshold anyway, although this could change once they get implanted. There's no reason why that shouldn't happen once you have a lobby getting going. But yet it is central to development today in many countries to have public procurement to help to get networks working, to get all these development synergies operating in a local area, or at a higher area. And arguably, they'd be even more important in the future. If you take local development today with all these massive unused resources around and the various people trying to develop on a local basis, this intervenes in that. Again, the benefits for TISA are absolutely minuscule. It's just the equivalent of a cup of coffee every 2 months for people. So again, you have this for each citizen in the EU, from the official analysis. And so you again have this massive intervention for this absolutely minuscule economic benefit, even in the most optimistic analysis. There are some references then which I just mentioned, but including the question of how services have been turned into markets through this mechanism, but I think it's worth reading her on that. I'll skip the precautionary. Just one thing, the cost-benefit analysis of regulations. I have to finish up shortly. Yeah, in fact, I don't know. So I have two slides left. There is one could develop, in fact, an alternative good regulatory practice. And so, what might it look like? So one could suggest, for example, based on all what has gone before, is to have in trade agreements a stronger assertion of the right and the ability to regulate without putting excessive disciplines on it, like the way that's done in the moment, at the moment that I discussed earlier, and like the necessity test and the way it's used, etc. The infamous necessity test, one could say. To give sufficient attention to the benefits of regulation, in other words, to those black bars that there were in the graph that was put up, which are arguably an underestimate. Evaluate regulations on multiple criteria, not on narrow neoclassical cost-benefit analysis. that's a discussion in itself. Recognize that many regulatory decisions are political. So don't take them out of the air, because these negotiations typically often take place in secret, and certainly the institutions that are to take place are not transparent subsequently. For major regulation you need democratic decisions, you need democratic debate, because a lot of issues around food safety or the climate or financial regulation or whatever require a wide debate, as was, for example, in the case of the European REACH regulations on toxic chemicals. So don't create institutional mechanisms that look only at the costs and burdens for business. Instead, create mechanisms to identify benefits and how they could be increased, give much greater attention to distinguishing between the private interest and the public interest, and don't confound these things as being the same, because they're often quite different. Give adequate attention to the precautionary principle in regulating and when it should be invoked, and avoid mechanisms that impose a very heavy and hence a biased burden on governments and civil society organizations, like mechanisms where you have to participate. There are more efficient ways of organizing regulatory discussions, debates, etc., to lead to a conclusion without having endless meetings where the civil society organization just cannot keep up. There's some references there, which I mean I'll send this to you. These are in the paper. I think all of those are in the paper. Like for US regulations, the Thomas McGarrity book. Now this will become extremely important. It is extremely important, but this will become very relevant in the current era, because the use of the American systems of blocking and doing away with regulations is going to be put on steroids in the Trump era. I think I'll leave it there. So I'll, yeah. So, look forward to it. I have one slide on the new American ministry, but I'm not going to present it now. If in the discussion, maybe we might. I'd like to give an opportunity. I prefer to give an opportunity to the discussants. And again, I apologize for sending this stuff so late.
So thank you very much for your presentation. My name is Thérèse, I'm from France, and this is Salam from Jordan. And we want to present some aspects of your paper on moving regulation out of democratic reach, taking the example of the CETA. So after a short introduction, I will speak of some aspects of context and content on the CETA. Then I will focus more on what is the regulatory cooperation, and then I will leave the floor to Salam, who will speak about the impact of regulatory cooperation in terms of democratic outreach. So just to introduce this subject, I wanted to illustrate how it was a sensitive subject and how it was dividing on one hand the decision makers and on the other hand the civil societies. And you can easily see this just taking some glance at the website. If you go on the Commission website, you can see that they are really strongly insisting on the fact that they want to build high standards concerning environments, concerning regulations, that they will not harm, they will respect democracy. And if you go on a website of NGOs or other kind of website, you will see that they all say that almost all say that it's a huge problem and a threat for our democracy. So we can see here what kind of atmosphere we have around these issues. So just to focus on the CETA and to give you some context, the negotiation began in 2009. And finished in 2014. In 2006, so last October, it was signed by the Canadian government and the European Commission. And now it has been submitted to the European Parliament, and it should be ratified like next week, I mean this month. Then once it has been ratified by the European Parliament, you will have a provisional implementation, which means that all the commercial part will be implemented, but then we will need to wait for the ratification of all member state parliament before having the definitive adoption. So what is it about? It's about, so you have a liberalization of 99.8% of tariffs line, which includes 100% of industrial lines and about 92% until 94% of agricultural line, strong liberalization of investment and services, high level of protection for investors, and of course what we are interested by here is regulatory cooperation. So what is the regulatory cooperation in the CETA? In the paper you define it by the interaction between the parties to align regulations and to adopt a global set of good regulatory practices, and also you say that it's characterized by the fact that it covers a large area, not only trade but also investment, and that it could possibly have some impacts on regulations that in fact have little to do with trade. And the objective, presented in the official documents on the CETA, are to eliminate unnecessary barriers to trade and investment, to enhance competitiveness, efficiency and innovation of industry, to improve regulatory process, and this is a quote, to contribute to the protection of human life, health or safety, animal or plant life or health, and the environment. And as you say, the word to contribute is very weak. It doesn't mean you want to improve it. It doesn't even mean that you want to maintain it, but just like more or less you will be part of it, which is like a very broad concept. So how they will do this regulatory cooperation? Mainly we identified two mechanisms. The first one is the recognition of the equivalence of both sides' regulations, which means that, for example, you can have, the European Union can have like very specific regulation on food safety for one specific product, and for example for cheese, and for the same product, so Canada will have also regulation that might be also strict, but that are not completely the same. So the equivalence, the recognition of equivalence, is when the two sides will say, well, we recognize that your regulations are equivalent to ours. But the problem here is that you can have very strong differences between Canada and EU, especially if you think about GMOs or animal welfares. You can have very strong differences. So we can ask ourselves, how will they do? They cannot recognize any equivalence. And then the second mechanism is mutual recognition. And it would be implemented when the process of recognition has failed. And once again, we don't know much how they will do it, because when it was done before in other agreements, it was within the EU or with the Australia-New Zealand agreements. And in both, the mechanism was that they put a like floor regulation. But once again, as we have very strong difference, it could mean like we are going to level down regulation. Another important issue about the CETA and this cooperation around regulation is the fact that Canada is closely linked with the US. Especially regarding regulatory cooperation, they even have the Canada-United States Regulatory Cooperation Council, And of course, Canada is exchanging much more goods and services with the US, which means that Canada will rather align its regulation with the US rather than with Europe. You already spoke a lot about this, so I don't know if I should insist, but it's just to say where does this willingness of country to do this cooperation come from. And as you said, in the GATT system, it was a completely different approach, as domestic regulation were considered as sovereign matter. Then you had this big change during the 70s in the US approach, with a global change in their economic context. And then domestic regulation began to be seen as visible barriers to trade, and the US advocated for it to be taken into account in different trade agreements, and they finally succeed because now within the WTO system, it's considered as non-tariff barriers. So today, regulations are seen mainly as cost and burdens. And I will now leave the floor to Salam.
Do you mind if you change the slides? So I will speak about CETA effect on the regulatory process. We can see that it's more or less oriented by having the least trade restrictive or the least investment restrictive regulations. All of this can be summarized under what is called or what is known as the necessity test. And the necessity test is in a way that they are trying to figure out if the policy or regulation that is under consideration is in fact achieving the objective or the other least trade restrictive distorting is the one that are achieving it. The other point is any opposition toward these restrictive or these necessity tests will actually lead to the opposing part to go through dispute tribunal. So they will actually face court charges if they did so. And when I say dispute tribunal, it's a way like it's less formal than the court standard system, and it's faster and it's cheaper to settle down claims among the opposing parties. And these necessity tests were applied even without taking any adequate assessments, whether the country that they're putting those this necessity tests in it are in fact comes in a line with their regulatory goals or they are feasible to be achieved anyway. The overall, we can see the effects of CETA or other international trade agreements by having that the overall standard of regulations are facing delays, blockages and reductions. For an example, in the EU, that took the form of reducing the staff, having reductions in staff in the commissions and other supporting regulatory agencies. A similar comparable case was in the States in the mid-90s, where they had additional steps of regulations, which led for them to have the overall quality of regulations to go down and resulted in budgetary constraints. Democracy and control. Well, to start with, the Commission's launches CETA based on a provisional purposes, meaning that it will take place without actually having all the countries officially sign on it. So that's in its by itself is a validation for democracy. Also, the professor mentioned a lot about transparency, which is one of the most important areas where you have those under the regulatory cooperation. And yet, it's one of the most also important areas that has no enforcement on it whatsoever. So only transparency is important when we're talking about local companies, but it's not really important and it's completely marginalized if we're concerning about the activities of CETA itself. Can you go
to the other slide?
Yeah, because this is, for example, the CETA Joint Committee is the top body of CETA, and it's the one that makes all the decisions. And all the specialized committees, they make recommendations to the top committee, to the Joint Committee, but there is no indications how the decisions are based. Like, there's no indications of transparency. So another point that also emphasized that, because if you do not share with the public about how your agendas, your reports, your documents, also that means you're not prioritizing the interest of public. Another also point that we don't have transparency in the whole process of CETA. Also, most importantly, the last point. No, can you go back to the... Yeah, the ISDS, which means that investor-state dispute settlement mechanisms. What does that mean? Basically, it allows big corporations to sue governments if they are standing in the way of any potential profits of those corporations. And you also talked about like making it up to the public and say about their opinion. 97% of the Europeans rejected having ISDS due to public consultations, but it went through anyway. And the problem with ISDS is it doesn't just allow Canadian firms to have the capability of suing the government, but it allows any firms that have offices of in Canada. So that mainly mostly all the US companies. And that fundamentally changed the relationship between foreign investors and the court system and the governments of the two parties of the agreement. So the consequences and the implications of CETA. Thérèse talked about a bit about it, that you have two differential approaches between Canada and the States. And when you have two different parts of stuff, usually you are not really increasing the quality of where you're heading. And this is exactly what's happening. The Europeans have more quality regulations, they are more strict, and the Canadians, more like the Americans, they don't. And we see that they are both heading that downward with regards to the regulations. And not that, and that's not only it, because if we're going to take a look at the American regulations, even though they are not the best there is, but they had one thing that was actually working in their favor, which is called the tort law, which is basically that you're capable of suing in civil courts. If there has been a harm done to any person, then you create a legal liability of the person that is creating that harm, and you can sue that person. And that has been marginalized in the recent decades, so the overall now the regulations of the state has been weakened. So even that one advantage, we don't have it. So you will end up having the regulatory system of the US and Canada without having the tort law. Also, the professor mentioned the precautionary principle. And the precautionary principle in CETA is like barely mentioned. It's not really taken seriously, even though the precautionary principle is one of the most important anchors in the European system, because it's basically what holds together the whole health, environment, and the consumer's policy. And it's completely different from what is known in the States or Canada, because they don't have things as, let's think it through. They have the something called the follow-up approach. They go through the process, and then they handle the consequences. Whether it's bad or good, they will deal with it later, not before. And it's agreement like CETA will completely marginalize something as the precautionary principle, even though like it is mostly needed in industries like in agriculture, in biotechnology products, like big companies like Monsanto and their works. All of those, like they will, there are big companies that are exactly pushing for such international agreements, because they know that will mean the elimination and the undermining of precautionary principle, and that they will get away with what they do. Also, the professor talked about the cost of deregulation, because regulations are always think as burden. Regulations are costly, even though if we really thought about like what climate change can actually cost for us, what having toxic airs and air pollution and the deregulation of finance and potential financial crisis, all of those among many things, if we really took those in the way, they will absolutely outweigh the economic benefits or the alleged economic benefits of such an agreement. And plus the approval of CETA, because it's, again, it's like this is going through like next month, and the approval of CETA is like a trial for the approval of TTIP, which was mentioned by the professor. Mainly about like the patent rules, because still we having an agreement with like you have patent rules, like they're questioning the entire policies and the practicing system of the Europeans. Also among the patent rules, like that means the health cost will increase for the Europeans, because they cannot shorten those patents that they have for pharmaceutical drugs. Also, CETA undermines the rights of workers and environment. If you went through the textbook of CETA, it's like it's all about the enforcement of the investors' rights. They have explicit language. They're not trying to be vulgar, hide behind like big words. But when it comes to workers' rights and environment, there is no enforcement. It just and they do not say we want to improve the measurements. They just want to contribute to it. Public services are under attack through CETA. This is like what's so-called the negative list. Unless the public governments have specifically said that these services are going to be done and offered by the public, they will be as if everything is going to be privatized, meaning that those services will be up for competition by foreign investors. Any kind of services, unless it's explicitly specified by the government that they will not be up to public services. And that, like, and this is like, you cannot do undo once you put something for privatization and competition. The whole quality, the whole dynamic of the market changes completely. This is like, also like, those are not comprehensive of what the implication. The implications goes beyond to the farmers, to the quality of food, and this has been talked a bit about the seminar before. But this is more or less of a broad picture of what would happen if something went through. Can go to the questions now. So in your paper that you were discussing earlier, you mentioned about alternative perspectives, but like you didn't really talk about how those perspectives can be actually enforced. Because of course we want to prioritize the public interest, but like how is that going to be done? Like we, of course, like you talk more like of an ideal set of how things are supposed to be, but how are we going to reach that ideal set? Also, like Canada is, I think it's the third country that has been sued by governments or the other way around. So it's very, it went through a lot of court battles with US corporations, regardless of who started. How does the whole dynamic gonna be under CETA with the court system? Finally, with the deregulation of finance, international trades like CETA will only further deregulate the banks that we have. What do you see that, what can you say about the future of financial regulation? And we have another.
Considering all the change we have with the election of Trump, the Brexit, and an overall discontentment towards this trade partnership, can you see any change in the way the European Commission, for example, is considering it? And what are, in your opinion, the perspective in this area? And then a last question was about taking the perspective of developing country. As trade partnerships put high requirements on regulations from their point of view, and it's seen as a way for developed country to settle trade barriers. So what is your opinion on this subject, and do you think that developed countries should accept to import products made in suspicious conditions, or they should uphold the requirements? And if not, what is the legitimacy of developed countries to impose their view as opposed to sovereignty of these countries? I'm not sure it was. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your presentations. I thought they were terrific. I thought they brought out very well and enhanced and added to what I had said in the paper. I thought it was very rich what you were saying. I thought it was really outstanding. On your questions, some of them are easier, some of them are much harder to answer. So I think I'll start with the easiest ones. I didn't address, you say that Canada has lost a lot of court battles. I neglected to distinguish for the general audience between the two systems of dispute resolution. There's the state-to-state dispute resolution, which the Americans call government to government because they call the state the government. And you have the investor state dispute settlement. You spoke about the second, which I deliberately stayed away from because there's lots of people working on that and some absolutely outstanding people like Gus Van Harten from Canada. There's a lot of people who have produced excellent work on it. So there was no point, I wouldn't be able to add anything to that. So that's a subject I didn't address. What's the precise question? Lost a lot of court battle. Will that be different under CIT? No is the answer. There's no reason why it should be, except they have this what they claim is this new court system, the investment court system, which they claim has got over the difficulties. After all, the criticism of the ISDS system, the EU brought in this proposal of investment court system after the agreement was concluded, and they got Canada to agree to that as well. And the proposal is to have this as a worldwide basis. And they claim that it has dealt with a number of the criticisms, including conflict of interest of the judges, because they're prosecuting cases for companies on one moment and they're sitting as judges the next moment, or the next period, for example, and question of transparency, there's several questions, and indeed that has been discussed a lot by Gus Van Harten. Again, I would emphasize to read what he has said in the investment court system as a replacement for what is ISDS. Now, in fact, the investment court system, this is playing with the words, because the investment court system, they say, is not ISDS, but in fact it is ISDS, because it's important for us to realize there's actually only two systems, the state-to-state dispute settlement, or there's a company state in a investor state dispute settlement. There's no third system. The investment court system they're talking about is still ISDS. It's a relabeling of it, but it's still investor state. And of course, the arguments that have been put forward about investor state dispute settlement is that this gives special rights to foreign investors that are not available to domestic companies. There's many criticisms of it, how the system works, that it's unfair, etc., and that it blocks public regulations in the public interest, and even blocks regulations that are being thought of. And there's evidence in Canada for that. But I don't want to discuss that very much, except to say that it will. Gus Van Harten, who I think is outstanding, he doesn't see any significant change, any material change really, to the system. It's certain improvement in terms of transparency, etc., but it doesn't get over the main problems that there are with the previous way of doing it. And indeed, European companies will be, or at least European governments will be, much more exposed to suits, not only from Canadian companies, but as you point out, from American subsidiaries in Canada. Anyway, so I'll just say that. Sorry, just catch those. I can't address the question on financial regulation, except that there are people who are working on it. Like, for example, in fact, notably, Miriam van der Stikkele of SOMO, S-O-M-O, in the Netherlands, has done a lot of work on this. But I've deliberately stayed away from it because that's a very specialized area. But she says that it's very dangerous. And in fact, I quoted in the TTIP paper the head of Finance Watch, who said that to a European Parliament committee that the problem about organizations or trade agreements like the TTIP is this is they set up these bilateral regulatory activities, whereas in fact finance, because it is global, needs to be regulated at a global level, and that in itself could actually cause problems. let me see that one. There's the fifth one, taking into account of developing countries. Yeah, developing countries. You're completely right, and this is an argument that is put forward. Should unsafe products be allowed into the EU because they come from developing countries? Well, I think most people would say no, they shouldn't. But a lot of this is not about safe products. I mean, that was set up under the WTO system in 1995, as agriculture came more and more into the trade agreements and food exports came under the trade agreements. They have this SPS system, sanitary and phytosanitary, in other words, animal and human and plant health and safety. And that's meant to pick that up, and so that countries can in fact stop, and they do through inspections at the borders, products come in. But that's only a part of what we're talking about. There's vast areas which have to do with regulations of all sorts. I mentioned so many of them. And which affect developing countries, and this question of, and which impinge on their, which have nothing to do with product safety, which impinge on their policy space. You've probably discussed the question of policy space in this arena, but it completely narrows down the policy space of these countries, which is simply essential. I think the interesting development economists would say. Including people like Hajun Chang, but a whole from Danny Roderick and a whole range of people also. So the legitimacy of developing countries to impose their view, well, it's, why do they do it? Because they can, as they say. This kind of, they have the power to do it. There's a very interesting book by Yash Tandon, T-A-N-D-O-N, called Trade is War. And he was the head of the South Centre, which is based in Geneva, which is a body, or sort of an institution, which is to help the developing countries in their negotiations with the rich countries. Anyway, he discussed it there, and what he discusses some issues that you never hear about in the press, about how meetings are fixed and how developing country opposition has been sidelined by splitting them, by all sorts of techniques, including using suddenly producing a proposed document for a result which has never been seen by the developing country, and you have to vote for it, then all this kind of thing. So there are all these techniques, but that's discussed in that, and indeed in other books. There is the recent politics of EU and the US. If I could just, that was the other slide. Which I left for the discussion. Yes. I don't know how I get that up to the big. No, that doesn't do it. Yeah, that does it. I don't know. Anyway, excuse me one second when I go further. Is that working? Is that working? Anyway. So, it is probably big enough to see. So the new US administration, what impact would it have? Well, Peter Navarro was, it was reported in the Financial Times 2 days ago that he's the formal head of the trade policy in the Trump government. I say formal because not all of the Trump administration is very formal, as we know. But because of his position, it would seem that the TTIP is dead. And in fact, he added that the EU was in fact, and this is the position they take, that it's an umbrella entity, and in fact composed of different countries. And as far as I can see, what the new administration is doing is having a completely different approach to previous American administrations, which helped to build and indeed led the building of this international system, which they benefited from above all, even if there were some things which didn't suit certain people in the United States, especially less skilled workers. That's a longer debate, but this new administration would seems to be going completely against that, and indeed possibly even trying to blow up these international systems, because they're basically saying that multilateral things we don't want, that ties our hands too much, etc., and we lose out on them, they're unfair on the United States, even if in reality the history of these organizations are that the United States has a preeminent influence on how the things operate in these organizations. And it seems, as far as I can judge, that they're trying to do down any competitors that might be strong enough to compete with the United States. So we see China, we see Germany, we see the European Union, we've seen this in recent days in the newspapers. So but also Pascal Ami, who was the head of the WTO, said that they have a conception of trade of 40 years ago. And my interpretation of that is it means manufacturing, tariffs, and currency manipulation, which is what they have talked about. regulatory cooperation, I don't think there's any possibility of regulatory cooperation, or indeed possibly even any cooperation between at least the EU and the US. And also the new administration has a tremendous hostility to regulations, and they've put in people who are hostile to the mission of the various agencies, the Environmental Protection Agency and all the various most, at least, of the other agencies. They're focused on manufacturing, and TISA is not manufacturing. So, and because Goldman Sachs and a number of the big banks are well represented in the business forum around them, maybe they will push that forward. But again, that's multilateral, so who knows. And U.S. services do gain a great advantage, including some people who deal in hotels and golf courses. And the last one is the one I really want to emphasize, that it seems that other trade agreements among other countries is getting a major push from the fact that the U.S. wants to pull out of the international trade. The others seem to want to emphasize the trading system. So the Chinese-centered agreement, which is being worked out, the RCEP and the UN-Japan free trade agreement is now come back very strongly on the map. and you see the business Europe and the business the Japanese Business Association put forward a joint document on regulatory cooperation in December, which is interesting, and it's got all the ways of doing the things that the transparency, the all these kind of things that you know is in this OECD type of good regulatory practice, and indeed is embodied in the CETA proposals, etc. Yeah, I think I'll just leave it there. Oh, wait a while. There's one question I didn't answer, which is the one about the public interest, how it needs to be done. Yes, that's the most difficult question because I think it needs opening up of these of debates on these issues. I think many more people need to engage in the debates, and they need to understand what actually these systems are. What is being negotiated here? What are being proposed, and opening that up further for debate. There has been a lot of debate on some of these things, but some of them, for example, the fact that the economic benefit that's proposed is absolutely tiny. So that the maximum benefit that was found in the impact study of the TTIP is a cup of coffee equal to a cup of coffee for each European person every week. So the whole TTIP massive engagement would be for that, and that was to be the benefit from it. In the CETA, it would be a cup of coffee for each European person every 2 months. In the TISA, the same. So the economic benefits, which they keep arguing for, is what these things are about. They're absolutely minuscule. I think if people were more aware that this is the case, even in the best case of the commissioned impact studies that they got, that could also make a difference. But I don't want to talk too long, so I'll leave it at that. Sorry.
Thank you again for your presentation. My name is Magdalena, I'm from Germany, and I'm interested in the question of how you could involve the civil society more. Or is it in general, you think it's possible to do something like this if there are benefits for the public? Or is it just in the nature of these agreements that they are made for business and therefore including the civil society would kind of make it impossible to agree on something because the interests are so difficult? So is it just for business and therefore you have to exclude civil society to make it work? Or could there be something that would be more democratic and still have maybe some public benefits? Thank you.
Should I answer? Yeah. Or do you want to gather? Or go on.
Answer now.
Okay. Yes, absolutely, civil society could be involved more. We're talking, these agreements are not essentially about trade. Okay, they are about investment, but there's huge problems with that. But insofar as they're about regulations, although I have to say regulations cover investment also, so but nevertheless, insofar as they're about regulations, there is a possibility for different countries to learn from each other's regulations in order to improve the benefits of regulations, these massive benefits that come from regulations. And you could have discussions on that basis. How are we going to, you know, better deal with toxic chemicals in our country? You have a better, seem to have a better system. It works better. Say, for example, many NGOs in the United States say that the REACH system in Europe is vastly superior to their system, which doesn't work. It only bans a very small number, a tiny number of chemicals. I think they've managed to ban five chemicals or chemical families over a period of about 30 years or something like that. And similarly, the financial regulation is sometimes stronger in the United States than it is in Europe. But you have very powerful forces trying to affect this. So in order to bring that about, I think the public at large needs to know more about what's actually going on, how policy is made. I think in economics, one tends to study what is the best policy and not how that policy could be, you know, the policy system as to how it works. I'm not saying that's always the case. Maybe you don't, but nevertheless, that tends to be the approach. But unless you understand how these things work, how these things function, you may have the best policy in the universe, but it won't get implemented. So these dynamics, the sort of political type dynamics, political economy dynamics, are needed to affect change, to be able to affect changes in politics. Changes in policies. There are huge interests, private interests involved in the question of regulations, who want weaker regulations, and they have a huge. Read McGarrity's book, Freedom to Harm, which encapsulates the thing. They're for freedom, economic freedom. Hayek, Friedman, Buchanan, but it's the harm. And in fact, he says that they're actually harking back to the Gilded Age of the late 19th century when they're talking about these things. Because economic freedom, which it was emphasized very much by people like Friedman and Hayek, was the dominant ideology, explicitly like that, economic freedom in the period, let's say the 30 years period up to the end, up to 1905, when there was all these massive, massive mining disasters. There was trains running off the rails and catching fire. There was and the enormous financial crisis of 1907, etc. So. And then you had a regulatory period brought in, the so-called progressive period, then et cetera, et cetera. But he goes through the various phases. But from the 1970s, there was the companies got organized, and they started funding these think tanks, these very well-known think tanks nowadays. And they have completely changed the debate in many ways, because they produce reports that are constantly critical of the regulatory agencies, and they keep using the term job killing regulations, and they manage to the tort law system, which you talked about in America, that that's done at the state level, and judges in the United States go for election, and they need money to be elected, and they intervened there. So their election campaign. In 40 of the 50 states, judges are elected, and so anyway, McGarrity goes into all these different things, the way things are. But that's now created a situation where you have a Republican administration. You have Republicans in Congress who are extremely hostile to regulation. And for them, this is not a question of debate. It's just a question of fact, job-killing regulations, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, but I would recommend that. So is that okay? Yes, actually. So it's that first one on U.S. regulation. Thomas McGarrity. There's a reference in the paper. The book is called "Freedom to Harm." So I'll send this and but actually these are. These are all referenced in the papers, but nevertheless, I'll send this. In fact, if it's of any interest, I'll send simply the slides there, and you can pick them out there together.
Hello, thank you for the presentation. My name is Yelena. I'm from Kazakhstan. I was wondering, you mentioned that there has been cost and benefit analysis before, like different regulations. And for this one, can we identify who is like the loser, who benefits, who loses from this specific regulation in terms of different countries, consumers, like, I don't know, big producers, small producers? Can we have like some idea of who's going to benefit more, who's going to lose more?
Of? Well, regulations have costs and they have benefits. Now, you don't have to measure the benefits. You can measure the benefits in various ways. The numbers of lives saved. You don't have to put a monetary value on it like is done in neoclassical welfare economics. You can just say so many hundred, so many thousand lives saved by this regulation. And you can weigh up these different things. You say, well, it costs this much for business, etc. But business also needs regulations are good for business in some cases. And in fact, in the TTIP paper, one of the three papers, some examples are given there. It means that, for example, that they don't have to inspect coming into a factory all the time. They don't have to inspect everything. Because if that already have regulations to keep that at a certain level of quality, they save money through doing that. For example, I give some other example there as well. There is also the pattern of time in these costs and benefits. The costs are usually required now, so you've got to clean the effluent from your factory into the river or into the sky. That you have to do that now, but the benefits come and all. The lives saved or the people who don't get sick over a period of 20, 30 years or whatever. And this raises a very interesting, a very important question about the way cost-benefit analyses are done, and that is discount rates. And for the climate, this is of the phenomenal importance. Because The IPCC, the United Nations Climate Program, uses these, and they're also done. And this is very relevant to today, to some of the previous question about the United States and the new American administration. It comes up in what is calculated as the social cost of carbon. So. In the various regulations, and the Trump government has said, at least the people who are helping in the transition team are saying, we're going to go for this. Because one of the main, I said, well, the social cost, the Americans have put in, What they did is they had three integrated assessment models, which were, it's just a combination. I don't know what, to what extent you've done this before, but they're a combination of science climate models and economic models together. And there are three of those that they have chosen, and they take the average, essentially, of those three. But those climate integrated assessment models are highly problematic. One of the issues that comes in is the question of a discount rate, because the benefits occur in the future, and if you have a high discount rate, that's going to dramatically reduce the weight of the benefits in your cost-benefit analysis, because if the costs are sure, if you have high discount, it's not going to make any difference hardly. And there, this shows a number of different discount rates. Nicholas Stern revolutionized the economics of climate change with the Stern report in 2007. And he took a discount rate of 0.1%. So that, in other words, future generations, that their lives were worth as much as our lives. They put the 0.1% for a technical reason, which is not, but it's close to zero. It's zero in effect, virtually. Now, but William Nordhaus, who's the most well-known American climate economist, came along and said, well, he shouldn't have used 0.1%. He should have used 3%. That's what I use. And 3% is this line, which means that any benefit that takes place, in other words, lives saved or damage that doesn't take place in shall we say 50 years time, is only worth 22% of its value is what goes into your calculation of benefits. It's in other words, it's only worth 22% of its actual value at that time. And the same, these are various discount rates, but the European Commission recently had a thing about, also in the climate area, but energy efficiency, which is one of the three main areas of the EU climate policy. And they used a discount rate of 17.5%, and I just added this to the other ones I had done before, because to show its effect. Now, the NGOs were outraged at this, and I have to say I haven't studied it, and but there was some consultancy. Yes, that's the best term. Who said that this is just not right? But I haven't read the stuff. I've gathered the stuff, so I can't really say about it. But it's interesting, because what this Frank Ackerman, who I've mentioned, has a book on climate, which is a very good title: Can We Afford the Future? Because the point is that people like Nordhaus and others say, well, it's a waste of money to spend on climate change. In fact, Nordhaus says it, because people in the future will be much richer than we are, and they will be able to deal with it then. Now, of course, we can see that the climate, and here the precautionary principle can come in. We can see that there's a huge amount of uncertainty about the climate, and uncertainty is central to the precautionary principle. Is that you take action in a context of when there isn't scientific certainty, but there is a danger of irreversible, major or irreversible harm. And in the case of the climate, we're talking about irreversible harm. Because obviously, if we take two things in particular, the melting of the glaciers, the melting of the ice sheets in Greenland and in Antarctica, etc., that's not reversible within a period of tens of thousands of years. Anyway, And similarly, with loss of species is also irreversible, which also has a major is a major problem. So anyway, so this is something really interesting to follow up, maybe at some point in the future, because well, if we ever get to a future with climate change, but anyway, so that's relevant to what we're talking about, because cost-benefit analysis is used to say you should not regulate. And in the case of climate, I mean, what's to be said? I mean,
thanks. Okay, I have another question, and this relates more to this investment arbitrage topic that comes with these trade agreements. Investment arbitrage between states and states, but also states and companies. You said you're not very deep into that, but maybe you can still answer. It's a more fundamental question, because I was wondering how a parliament can ratify a treaty on trade that constrains its future decision-making power, how this can be ever a democratic decision that you don't allow your future generations to change the law, otherwise you would have to compensate the company that might be harmed and that it invested and all this context. I'm very puzzled that this is even possible, but it seems to be everyday practice somehow.
Yes, I can only agree completely that, but nevertheless it happens. And how come it happens? I think that's something that we have to that's something that we have to understand in order to especially as you're a social scientist, you need to I mean, this is what I've been arguing, that you've got to understand the policy making process, you've got to understand how lobbying takes place, etc., etc. In any case, how does it actually happen? Is your question? Well, because the debate is muddied. People think that there's a lot to be gained, and there's also, are you pro-trade or are you anti-trade? And if you're on the liberal side of the spectrum, you'd be terrified if somebody called you anti-trade. So often things are reduced to a very simple level, and they don't. The debate often, at least, that comes through to some of these parliamentarians don't is a very muddy debate, and the think tanks are there to muddy the debate sometimes. Not to clarify it. There was something I was going to say there, which is really interesting, but it'll come back to me. yeah, wait a second. Now, let me just think. CETA. Yes. The Wallonian Parliament in Belgium has been hammered by a large part of the political spectrum, from many social democratic leaders, some social democratic leaders, let's say, although there's a divisions within the social democrats, across to the right of the rest of the spectrum, the liberals, etc., saying, and indeed, a group of lawyers came out, but who these lawyers are is an interesting question in itself, but that's another story. And what links they have with companies, etc. But in any case, companies, the lawyers. Yes. So the debate is often put in such a way that's the way it is. Now, the Wallonian Parliament, more than any other parliament in Europe, in fact, far more than in any other parliament in Europe, looked into what the CETA is about. And they had hours and hours of hearings on it. They got experts to talk to them. And they went through it. And they actually identified positions, and they sent to the European Commission a year before the thing blew up. People were saying, well, why didn't you send that to the Commission before? But they had sent it a year before, and they got no reply. At least that's my record. That's, I think, what they were saying themselves, if I remember correctly. So that's part of the answer. There are a lot of vested interests involved in these debates as well, and in affecting them. So anyway, that's, I think, what I could say on that.
Good afternoon. I'm Sukriti. I want to ask you, how effective do you think cost-benefit analysis actually are? Because, given, like you said, there's a lot of subjectivity involved, and it's actually not possible to always quantify the effects of a regulation. And so shouldn't we use or complement it with more qualitative analysis? And
yes, I think is the short answer. I would agree very much with you. That Frank Ackerman has a great book, Priceless, it's called. And it looks at things like things we consider, human beings consider to be prices. That is, they don't have a price, and you don't want to put a price on it. The surveys, they use surveys because of methodological individualism associated with neoclassical welfare economics. The way they solve some of these problems, like how do you put a price on somebody's life? How much is it worth? How much is your life worth? What they do is they go, well, there are different ways, at least a couple of different ways of doing it. One is to say, well, people in the building industry, for example, say a dangerous industry, for example, the building industry, how much are wages there differ from wages elsewhere? And so that would show what the premium is for taking the risks, and we can calculate how many people die and the building industry or get injured, etc., and so do a calculation there. But one of the things with these surveys is that there's a very high rate of people who say, I refuse to respond to this question. This is a completely invalid question. And those are just, again, using social scientists' well-practiced techniques of getting rid of the unsuitable data. They just simply don't count these things. They don't. So they only take account of the people who respond. In any case, the value of a human life, you'd be sad to know, or at least the Europeans here will be sad to know, is much lower in Europe than it is in the United States. The Americans calculate it's about $9 million for a human life is worth, and in Europe it's calculated to be $1.5 million euros. So, of course, if you cross the Atlantic, you become worth a lot more. So, anyway. But Ackerman talks about these kinds of questions. Look, you can't put price in the... But there are ways, and in fact, there is, and it was given more emphasis in the past in the European regulatory system of how to do impact studies, that the multi-criteria analysis, which you can use, you don't have to you don't have to put everything in monetary amounts like the neoclassical cost-benefit analysis. You can, as I was saying earlier, you can say, well, if this saves so many lives, it's going to cost this, et cetera, et cetera, and have a debate. Because public debate shines light in these things. They say, but you never thought of this. And people come up, NGOs, anybody from civil society, if it's a wide enough public debate, and the companies, small companies, can say, well, look, this is a problem for us, and we would prefer it solved this way rather than have the big companies dominate the debate. So public debate to shine light on all these things is essential. But what you say is to have if I understood you correctly, not to reduce everything to the standard cost-benefit analysis. But the opposite is happening in the EU. Things are moving more towards this neoclassical cost-benefit analysis. And it's one of the advantages of that from a technocrat's point of view is that it's not controversial. Or at least, these are technical decisions. The value of life is a technical thing. It's much easier to get something through without a major hassle in public debate. In other words, such methods do exist, and they should be used, and indeed they have been used in the European Commission, especially more in the past than now, because the thing is narrowing down now the way they do things, and the precautionary principle, as I point out in one of the papers, has virtually disappeared from the impact assessment system. The latest revision of it in 2015, under what was known as the Better Regulation Package. But I think that researchers, social scientists, need to inform themselves. They're the best place to understand it. They can read the different things. The NGOs who campaign a lot on things, they don't have money. They can't afford to employ researchers to do things. So anyway, that's what I have to say.